around. And we always have all of that. We always have that great talk in the green room. But and I know people, I need to start filming my green room like Oprah or something, right?
I think you should do the green room too.
The green room with the Philippe Matthews. Welcome back, everybody. Highly anticipated show. Thank you for tuning in wherever you are around the world. Dr. Louann Brizendine is back with us. She is the best-selling author of The Female Brain and The Male Brain. She is the world-leading expert on neuropsychiatry, specializing in relationship dynamics and that result from the neurobiology of male and female brains. And we were having a conversation about a week or so ago about what happened with America, how America changed on November 6, 2016, for better, for worse, depending upon what side you're on. And what fascinated me was my previous shows with Dr. Brizendine about epigenetics and the path of research that she sent me down to get to this point and to this conversation. And so the conversation was about, can hate be hardwired in the brain through socialization? So welcome back, Dr. Brizendine. Here we are again with another heavy topic, another heavy conversation.
Thanks, Philippe, for having me back. And indeed, I think after our election on November 8th, this is a heavy topic that needs addressing. So thank you. I really do appreciate the opportunity to speak to you again.
So let's talk about, I guess, setting the foundation, because some people have not heard of epigenetics, don't understand what it is, why it's so radically important to know, and why it's such a big discovery, because it's now beginning to really fill in some of the spaces that exist where we say, I don't know, what was that person thinking? Now we can begin to understand how we all got here, particularly this thing called America.
So I think that just to kind of put it in a nutshell simply in terms of what this big fancy word called epigenetics is. Epi means on top of, and of course genetics means the gene. So we all get these little epi decorations on top of our genes as from the time we're born till the time we die. And it's kind of new little decorations that come from things that are environmentally induced, like the pollution or the environment we live in, or the nutrition we have or don't have, or the abuse or comfort and support of our parents or the lack thereof, and you know, or the violence in our community, the unsafety, the fear versus the safety. All of those things in our environment decorate our gene in this epigenetic category. And why that's important, not just to us as an individual, which of course it is, why that's really important is that it's been discovered that this epigenetic decoration can be passed on for three generations. So those things that say you or I got from traumas in our childhood, traumas in our growing up, in our environment, our lack of nutrition or good nutrition, or you know, these things, or schooling, education, you know, fear versus all the other good things for comfort, these things are actually like little marks all over our genome, and we pass it on to our children, and then they pass that on to their children. So that's the general concept. It's a huge body of research and science right now, and new things are being discovered every day about that. So that's just what that word means.
Fascinating as it relates to this topic, and particularly the hate brain and the male and female, the differences in the male and female brain as it relates to hate, prejudice, racism, bigotry. We all know that how you were raised is. Pretty much how you're going to be as an adult. Not necessarily. Sometimes you make radical shifts in terms of how you were raised, but the socialization of how you were raised, who you were raised by, what you were around, shapes your way of thinking, shapes your self-concept, shapes who you are. What I'm understanding with epigenetics is that You know, and I don't know if I should use the word hereditary or some type of predisposition, that there are certain aspects of that child that and that father and mother that are in them three generations ago that actually triggers how that child is going to be raised. Can you walk us through kind of that little fine line? Because, you know, people say, well, you know, so-and-so wasn't raised the right way, or that's just how they were raised. How much does epigenetics play a factor in that versus just the conditions that family were born into and trying to live or create an American dream or an identity, if you will?
Well, I think that's really important. You know, basically we all know, right? We say, oh, that's just how he or she was raised, like you say. So in the under the umbrella of epigenetics, talking about something like that, we always say that's how he's raised, that's how she's raised, whatever. And so basically those parents who are doing the raising, or that grandmother, or those aunts, whoever they're being raised by, the raising is being done with people that have their own genes, their own epigenetics, their own decoration of their DNA that's happened from things that happened to not only to them, but to their parents and to their grandparents, back three generations, if you will. So now you've got a kid born into, let's say, a family. I mean, let's just take it for an example right now, because it's pertinent to what's going on in our country and a discussion that's up. Let's say that a kid is born into a family that the dads and the grandfather and et cetera have been part of the KKK, right? So they are born into a full-on racist family and racist culture and, you know, actively, aggressively racist. The chances, we always say, well, it's how that kid was raised, right? He's going to be more likely to grow up to be a racist than someone that was raised in a very different way. Let's say someone who grew up in Bernie Sanders' household, you know? I mean, as a difference. I mean, they're both Caucasian, right? They're both Caucasian. The parents of the KKK family kid versus the Bernie Sanders family group, you know, they have different values. They hear different things at the house. So the way their environment is going to form their epigenome, it's not hard enough wired that you can't unwind it or reform it or have, you know, different ideas as you grow up. You know, I mean, the kid that grew up in a KKK family may become very, very, be somebody who really fights against racism too. You know, that's a possibility. But we all know that's much less likely, right?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I think that it's important to realize that these kinds of things that we used to think were just the nature, nurture, that just that basically how you were nurtured and how you were raised, but to find out that it's actually biologically embedded in your genome in this epigenetic way, it's really been an eye-opener, I would say, for scientists in the last 10 years, so that it's more difficult to change that up than anticipated.
That's fascinating, because when we, you know, and I like the term that, how you're describing decorating a decoration or decorating their DNA. Kind of explain epigenetic tags, because I guess that's what you're referring to when you say kind of decorated, these tags that kind of appear and are placed in various different places on our DNA that tell the DNA, which is supposed to do a certain thing, turn it on or off, and to deny it or give it access, which is quite fascinating. That's just mind-boggling when you think about that. Talk to us about, if you could, go a little deeper into the tags, and then we can kind of go into, well, can hate, racism, bigotry, can that be socialized and hard? Can it be hardwired into the brain? And is there a difference then between the male and female brains? Go ahead.
So, I mean, one of the things about these little tags, it's kind of like, I like to think of them as like ornaments, ornaments on the Christmas tree, right. On that, you know, on the what do you call the stuff that you wrap around that rope, that gorgeous tinsel rope, you know, little decorations on that, you know, little ornaments on that. And the DNA would be represented by that rope, which is how our, you know, our chromosomes look like that. And what these little epigenetic, they're almost like little on-off switches. Mm-hmm. They either allow certain things to be produced in your cells, or they switch off and let things not be produced in your cells. So the reason that that matters is that during development, like in utero, the things can be, you know, your brain can change some things about your brain circuits, you know, about, we think about this, you know, clearly a lot in the male and female brain, and that, and in people who, you know, were traumatized, they get shut offs, they get the switch shut off for things that, that maybe, their fear circuits are really sensitive because they've been traumatized, and the epigenome just basically makes, throws the switch and makes them like really nervous, like someone who's got, you know, PTSD will jump when a truck drives down and backfires. These kinds of things are kind of wired into your nervous system. And the idea is also that that things that are wired into your nervous system for either being overreactive to certain things, or you can have the opposite where there's a lot of the switches are thrown on for being easily comforted or feeling more comfortable or being able to be, high, they say they're called high oxytocin people. You know, oxytocin is a love and cuddle hormone. There's people that, you know, more of that. So the the epigenetics can kind of gently shade and shift these things. It's not the main core of that rope of the chromosome and gene. So your brain circuit. So let's talk about our brain circuitry for what we call the social brain, Philippe. It's a really important concept, I think, for today's discussion about hate. Is about, you know, your social brain circuitry. Humans have amazing, the typical human has just so much of their brain circuitry that tracks all kinds of social interactions between people. You're always watching, you're always reading the tea leaves of what's going on, right? Mm-hmm. And then what your brain does is then interprets what it's seeing. You know, out of the corner of the eye, you see some guy, like, you know, running helter-skelter down away from something that just happened. You know, you're tracking all this stuff all the time. And basically, your social circuits are making interpretations. Oh, did that guy just do something bad, right? Or, you know, are the cops after him? Or, you know, all of a sudden, you start to make these little stories in your mind about what's actually gone on. You know, our brain is like a big bowl of social jelly. So, but why that's important back to our child raised in the KKK family versus the Bernie Sanders family, or, you know, in the issue of kind of hate or racial hate or racism or bigotry, whatever it is, or liberalism. I mean, it's, you know, it's that your interpretation of what you see coming down out there is based on how you were raised. And it's more than just how you were raised. It's actually how your hormones and brain circuitry, all these epigenetic parts of the on-off switches that you have to deal with, that will either make you tend to this direction or tend to another direction. So I think it's why, and so that said, let's say the KKK kid versus the Bernie Sanders raised kid is growing up now, and, you know, they all of a sudden they're in junior high or high school, and let's say they end up with a teacher. Let's say the kid that's raised in Mississippi from in a KKK family, you know, he's in school and he's got this teacher, he's learning about civics, he's learning about democracy, he's learning about our history, he's learning about a lot of stuff, and the teacher is helping him understand and learn about all kinds of different ways of thinking about things than he was raised in his family to think. Well, you know, some kids will just reject that, but some kids may have an open mind and be gradually opened up to seeing things a bit differently. You know, maybe this kid gets a girlfriend from, you know, let's say some liberal pastor who's been, you know, gone to theological seminary in New England, right? So has a daughter and they've moved down to Mississippi. He's the pastor of a local, yeah, and this kid goes, you know, so it's girlfriend, but the girlfriend starts helping him see things differently. That family starts helping him see things that are a little bit different. So gradually, even though our epigenome is set in a certain way and the family we grew up in is set in a certain way, we do have the ability to gradually change. And we learning is very quick, especially, you know, when you're younger. So experience is different than the nuclear family you were raised in can really start to open your eyes, you know, on either side of it. Bad experiences with, you know, let's say someone raised in the Bernie Sanders family, some, you know, kid gets traumatized by going to New York City and, you know, is beat up by a bunch of, you know, Puerto Rican kids or something. And now they have this big thing about, oh God, they have a fear thing about, you know, older Puerto Rican boys or something. You know, it's these events in all of our lives make us who we are and make us how we're going to see the world. And it also makes our epigenome get a different decoration on it every time something happens. Every time something happens to us, our epigenome gets some different decoration on it.
Wow, that's powerful. So let me pinpoint that for a moment. We know that your life, your environment, whatever socialization you're exposed to, will also have an epigenetic effect. But is there a difference between just regular day-to-day socialization versus a traumatic event and how that plays on the brain? And if you could, we've had previous conversations in this, could you bring out how that affects the part of the brain called the VMPFC, ventromedial prefrontal cortex, and how it shuts that part of the brain down? And then is that when that decoration or ornament on the epigenome, is that when it's, you know, triggered? Is that when it's formed? How does that nuance work?
Okay, so, you know, these really tight one-to-one correlations about what area of the brain and what's the epigenome. I mean, scientists are currently, you know, working a lot of that out. So a lot of this is just we don't know for sure, and it's hypothesis, but we have our little building blocks of, you know, the ventromedial prefrontal cortex, like you talk about, or this area behind your forehead, the prefrontal cortex, is that area that we use for planning and logic. We make a logical story out of something that's our amygdala, the whole emotional circuitry is like all stirred up. You're angry or you're upset or you're sad or you're, you know, you feel humiliated or ashamed, you know, all those things. That prefrontal cortex is, if it's strong, it can basically help hold all of those emotions and metabolize them into a plan of action to help you deal with those emotions, right? Mm-hmm. If you've been traumatized, your epigenome, you know, you've been traumatized in whatever way that was. It could be sexual trauma, it could be physical abuse, it could be neglect, it could be a nutritional, you know, trauma, you know, many, many things. It could be, can make it so that the brain and the prefrontal cortex just isn't strong enough. It's overwhelmed by the emotional piece. It's overwhelmed. It's not strong enough to form a plan, to logically make sense of the emotions, you know. And so, yes, it has to do with, you know, how much balance there is, how strong your prefrontal cortex is, your ventromedial prefrontal cortex, all those parts of our brain circuitry certainly play a role. So if that makes sense, it allows you to, so what we see, what you and I are really talking about, what we really care about as society, right? We really care about behavior, what comes out of that human being, right? So, you know, emotions, amygdala, prefrontal cortex, all these parts of the brain, hormones, all this stuff, that's all the juice that's cooking along inside that machinery in your head, you know, society doesn't really, they don't care so much about that except as how it deals with behavior, right? Mm-hmm. So, you know,
how it manifests itself.
So racism, hate crimes, you know, behaviors that we as a society say, we can't abide this and we got to do something about this, right? This is not right. So, but all that stuff that's cooking along in your brain, it's helpful to understand that because it's basically helpful to understand what is possible to do and how to go about doing something to see if we can kind of shift behaviors that are hate crime behaviors, shift what's actually going to come out of that person's brain as a behavior. That really is what we as a society care about.
So when we look at the male and female differences of hate, let's, you know, using the analogy that you gave between the KKK family versus the Bernie Sanders family. When we look at how this country is so split in half, so divided, we look at the violence that's happening in the streets. Are there differences in the male brain, or should I say the hate male brain versus the female hate brain? And what does that look like? And how does it outpicture and manifest connected to our epigenetics?
That's a really, really brilliant question, Philippe. That's really important because I don't think anybody else is asking that question right now. So let's take it apart. The hate brain, social circuitry in your brain, how you've been raised, if you're raised in that KKK family versus the Bernie Sanders family, I mean, how you going to manifest, you know, either love or hate towards people who are different than you are in any kind of way. And whether your brain is male or female doesn't really make a difference. You know, I'm going to do this. There's a leaf blower in the background, so I'm just going to shut the door. And so while I come
out, okay.
I can't
hear it, but it's probably annoying you. Sure.
There we go. So coming back to that. So all we really care about in society is the behavioral outcome of this. So looking at it through a male brain, female brain, hate circuitry in the brain for social circuitry is going to be the same in the male and female brain. That part of it probably isn't a lot different. Like both male and female brains, we notice differences in other people. We make up little stories about, you know, like I told you about the little example about the Puerto Rican kids that beat up the kid from the, you know, from the Bernie Sanders family, whatever. And then they start to get, you know, fearful of people who don't look like them or people of color, on and on, right? That, whether that was male or female, they would still have probably some of the same changes in their social circuitry of being fear of people of color, whatever that happened to be. The male-female brain, in terms of the circuitry of what's going on, is not that different. But the thing that happens is the behavior that comes out of that may be very different based on whether that brain is female or male for the following reason. So let's take the male first, because let's face it, look in the prison. I mean, what is it? 95% of people in prison are male for doing something bad, right? So, and
well, okay. So we have to preface that because the 2.5 million, primarily black and brown men that are in prison, yes, some I'm sure have done some horrific crimes, but it statistically is shown that because of institutionalized inherent racism and hate of a particular color of skin and descendants of slaves, that the actual penal system was designed to lock up and control as many black men as possible. So not sure if that's a good or fair analogy in the sense of...
Right, so I guess what I'm... So I guess the issue, like in psychology...
Well, I had to get political on that one, Doc.
No, that's really important. That's really important because it really does make a difference, and that's not unrelated to the hate brain that we're talking about. But the testosterone level between age 9 and 15 years old of boys goes up times 250.
Wow.
It's like a 25-fold. I mean, it's a 25-fold increase. It's like you're cruising along, you guys, and we're in then 9 to 15, wham! So you just, you see this skyrocketing. I mean, you know, if you owned a startup company, you'd be very happy with that. you'd go to the sky with that, you know? So by 15 years old, in the male body, the blood, brain, all of you and your muscles, everything, you know, and your growth. I mean, you're a 6'3" guy. You remember when, you know, you really started to grow and get big. And so all of a sudden, your biology is really different. You're big and you're strong and you've got, you know, and it's 10 times to 15 times more testosterone running around in your body than the female does in your entire life at every age group. So males have this musculature and a very fast 0 to 60 kind of aggression. So it's a 20-fold, the whole circuitry in the male brain and body work like 20-fold more on aggression that ends up being not anger. Females and males feel the same amount of anger in their brain, but the aggression, the outward behavior of the anger, 20-fold more male aggression that's physical.
So it's a hormonal difference and a hormonal response.
And it's, yeah, so it's all the genes that you guys have, that Y chromosome that makes you make the testosterone. Remember that 8 weeks of fetal life, those tiny testicles start to grow in the male fetus and it starts pumping out huge amounts of testosterone that marinates the male brain and body for the rest of that 9 months of that fetus's life. And by the time you pop out, you have male brain circuits and you've been marinated in testosterone, changed into male. So it's a lot of it's all due to your Y chromosome, dude. So that, wow, and your testicles. So those tiny testicles in the fetus pump out lots of testosterone. So you guys have already been marinated in that nice testosterone sauce by the time you come out.
I don't know if we're on a cooking channel right now. or
you got Martha Stewart. You're the new Martha.
Yeah, I don't know which. I'm trying to see what guests do I have right now. You marinated in the testosterone, you stirred, you heated for about 45 minutes and 9 months.
That's right. So the reason that I say that to you, though, is that all during that time, the circuitry in your nervous system, your muscles, your brain cells, your nervous system comes out male. And the female at the same time is being left all those 9 months unperturbed by testosterone. So, you know, we pop out with all this modification that testosterone makes that you guys already have. So wow, that you guys are primed already. And then when you get that big increase from 9 to 15 of all that testosterone pumping out of all of the, you know, the testosterone-making cells in the testicles, just like then have, you know, free reign. You guys remember what it's like when you're 13, 14 and you, you know, you've got a little bit too much juice to know what to do with most of the time. Very confusing.
Nice to bet.
Very confusing, you know. But that gets everything going for the – so.
But this does explain, though, why when you see a lot of the protesters, and not just protesters here in America, but when you see protesters and rioters, because there's a difference around the world, you see why they're so young. Most of them are young men, young males, you know, the 20s, you know, 30s. You know, as it gets a little old, some of them are out there older, but the majority are in the young adults and 20s. Now this is beginning to make sense.
So, and you see all the, you know, the immigrant, the people that actually get out and immigrate and make it from like either Africa, Syria, Middle East, or immigrating all through Europe right now. I mean, the bulk of them are young males under 35, you know. And so at any rate, you've got, you know, they're stronger, it's just like they are just, you know, and, you know, it's not that you know, we females have a whole another set of things. But so the hate, the feeling of anger is equal in male and female brains, feeling of anger. But the actual then anger causing, you know, aggression in just obviously not every male and female, but just the difference, that's 20 times more in males than in females.
Wow, 20 times more.
That's a big deal. That's the biggest behavioral difference between the genders, period.
Really?
Yeah. Even even sexual interest in males is always about 10 times more than it is in females. But it's not 20 times more. So aggression is the top, and then sexual interest is down at 10 times more than the typical female. I know there's a spectrum. Some females are more than male, but that's just the big numbers that we know. So it's important to kind of understand, the biology of this, because then in issue of hate in your brain, the feeling of hate, just like the feeling of anger, the feeling of hate or dislike of others or hate of others that are different than you or what, the feeling of hate is the same in the male and female brain. It's the behavior, what you do with that. Just like the anger is the same, then you get the aggression. So the feeling of hate and anger towards people who aren't like you, especially if you've been raised to hate people who aren't like you, like you're, a bigot or a racist or a misogynist, or, you hate anybody who's not like your group, your behavior, Philippe, if you're male, is going to take that anger and more likely turn it into aggression 20 times more if you're male than if you're female.
What you thank you for that, Doc. What you've just explained to me, I just recently had on Dr. Jacqueline Battalora, who is a professor of sociology and law at St. Xavier University in Chicago. And she wrote this incredible book and did this incredible research called Birth of a White Nation. And she actually went back and traced the laws back to 1664 to really 1681. When these what's known as the anti-miscegenation laws were created based on Bacon's rebellion, this rebellion of the 1%, and these 1% white males got so angry and so upset that they literally said, "We'll never have a rebellion against us again, against rich white educated men again." And so they created these laws that actually set up the laws before the Constitution that you can't marry outside of your race, and particularly one of African descent. Africans cannot own gunpowder. They cannot sue or take any legal action against white people. This is, it was backed by Christianity. This is actual formation of the laws, and it was the first time in American history that the word white was attributed to a race. So white people technically were invented in 1681. Now, what I'm hearing from you as I'm looking at this, looking at epigenetics and looking at also the hormonal aspect of this 20 times more, this level of aggression, what happened is it created this third class so that the uneducated, if there was such a thing back then called a middle class, whites had power over a particular race and group, which was African, and gave them a sense of esteem, a sense of purpose, a sense of efficacy. And it was a false sense, but it took away, it was a brilliant move in terms of the 1% taking off the heat where everybody was coming after the 1% and of these white males and saying, "Hey, this is not fair how we're being treated. We want fair wages, we want equality." But before these anti-miscegenation laws were created, you could marry who you want, there was no such thing as a white or black person or Negro. You were called a European or an African or what have you. Now I'm beginning to understand how this can be hard, how racism is epigenetically transferred, hardwired into the brain. What I'm hearing from you, though, in terms of male and female, so women have to, the female brain has to really, I guess, respond to all of this testosterone because they don't have that hormonal aggression or manifestation.
The fuel to drive the engine of aggression. Yeah, the fuel, the testosterone is the fuel that drives the engine of aggression.
Yeah.
Females do have some testosterone. You know, we both need it. We both have it. But females, of course, have a lot more estrogen. Males have some estrogen too, but a lesser amount. So okay. We're all human. You know, we're more alike than different. We are the same species. But on this particular thing that you're pointing to of like behavior and aggression, because of male hormones and also the biology of the male and the epigenetics of that, you know, it's very much, it ends up looking different. You know, you look at racism in females, right? So hate, let's think about racial hate in females towards other races. Well, it most likely it's going to come out somehow, right? But it's probably in females not going to come out as like physical aggression. You know, I'm thinking about the whole KKK world and all of this. I mean, I apologize. I don't know that much about that culture other than it's, you know, the stereotypes we have it of it being, you know, being like the major sort of white hate group in America. Mm-hmm. You don't see females necessarily marching around the middle of the night with their, you know, they were not part of lynching mobs. They were not, you know, so the female hate and racism wasn't going to come out in that direction. But, you know, female hate and racism towards others, you know, comes out in a different way. I mean, it comes out in being dismissive of somebody who's not like you, someone who's a different race than you are, being abusive to people who work for you. You know, it's like the female, you know, the house, things that happen in the household, right? So household help for, say, white racist females that are black or brown, you can see how behaviorally it can come out as being the hate and the racism comes out. I mean, I'm sure, you know, it comes out in the realm female behavior is going to be different in terms of the racism is the point. If you're an employer, a female employer, and you have, an African-American woman and a white woman, and you're a white woman as the boss, and, you know, you can spin it out, right? It's just you may not choose the person who's, like, the best at the job. You might discriminate against the African-American female. You know, you just, all of those things that are well-known, you're not going to punch her in the face. Female racism and hate doesn't come out in aggression in the physical way, in the physical aggressive way.
But it can in the same sense, in the same in proportion. Can you talk to us about, because I know you're in the neurobiological side of things. So I don't know if you can answer this question about cognitive dissonance and that what it took for the created white people to create the level of cognitive dissonance to make it okay to usher in chattel slavery for, you know, 339 years and then 100 years of Jim Crow. And what does it take? And can that cognitive dissonance be transferred as part of socialization, or is there a neurobiological component to it?
Well, the answer that you know that I'm going to say, just because of the field I'm in, is that yes, it was transferred from mother to daughter to, you know, it's transferred generationally because, let's say you're a plantation owner, that's how, you know, you're the gone with the wind female, you know, you're out, you know, that's transmitted generation to generation to generation of, you know, Southern white plantation owning women too, just like it was of men. So it was, and when you say the word cognitive dissonance, it basically, to me, that phrase means that if you check in with your own moral, ethical heart circuitry of how you treat another living being versus how your culture is telling you to treat another human living being that works for your family or is a, you know, slave, the issue of slavery at all. I mean, just, you know, there were whites in the South who, white women in the South who, you know, went north and they were really anti-slavery. You know, they were big movers in that movement, you know, in the history of the anti-slavery movement in this country. So even though some of them were raised like that, some Southern women, you know, really were big parts of the anti-slavery movement in the, you know, in the 1830s, 40s, 50s, 60s, and, you know, but you're talking about the cognitive dissonance, I think, of like, what is a human being would be a moral way to treat any other human being, no matter their anything about them. Mm-hmm. And the way your society is telling you to treat them, if you're raised, say, in a KKK family, that cognitive dissonance and how you feel that inside yourself and how you solve that problem of that tension is different for each individual. And we're all very susceptible. Remember, our social brain circuits are so tightly evolved for like, you know, a million freaking years about how you're supposed to get along with your own social group that you don't want to be ostracized from that group because if you were ostracized in the days we lived, like say in the wild, so to speak, you died, right? Your group throws you out, you go.
This is a very good point in terms of how you're connecting it to cognitive dissonance. And so that social group and how the brain is wired, when we're looking at a nation of laws, and they set these laws at the federal level of how a particular people are supposed to be treated, I can see how it can be extremely difficult to break away from that. Otherwise you just say, okay, I'm just going to go with the flow and the status quo. This is the new normal. This is very powerful. So it's almost, and I think you said something that, you know, even if you think hate for a group is wrong, depending upon your circuitry, you might not be able to stop it because your brain's ability to maintain your connection and wiring to your social group.
Bingo. I think that if there's any concept in all of how people behave when they do hate crime, when they act in a way, you know, you just said it all, Philippe. That is it. That is the core of the matter. You do not break with your social group because of basically fear of dying. If you get pulled off from your social group, or you get ostracized from your social group, you're going to die. That's how our brains are wired.
Wow, this is fascinating. That summed it up. Now, so here's what's interesting, though. Your father marched with King.
Yeah.
He was a pastor, right?
He was a white pastor in the, you know, in Kentucky and in that era. Yep.
You seemingly did okay, Doc. You came out all right. How did that happen? So how do you break when the country that you're living in, the society, all of the socialization, all of the media is saying that this group is no good, and especially particularly after slavery ended, they then moved it to, well, this group is really criminal and they're going to rape you and they're going to harm you and they're going to do all of these. How did you break from that social circuitry, that socialization, as well as your father, to, you know, thank God to your father for those epigenetic ornaments and decorations. Otherwise, we wouldn't have a Dr. Louann Brizendine right now. But how do you break from that socialization? Because it's so strong and there's the fear of death.
So
and create a new one.
Yeah. So When I was about 10 years old, my father, we'd been living in Southern California, and he decided to go back into the ministry and finish his theological degree. So, you know, I, as a 10, 11-year-old, we moved back from California to a little town called Lebanon, Kentucky, about 60 miles out of Lexington, which is where the what was then called the College of the Bible, now it's Lexington Theological Seminary, where he went back and did that. So we went back and lived in a community where the cities, the schools in the cities were still segregated. So fourth grade, I was in a segregated school in the South.
Wow.
My mother was a school teacher in the county school, which was integrated. And so she took us out of that city school and took us out to the county school that was integrated because they didn't, you know, like that. We were a big minority in that town because it was only 5% Protestant. It was 95% Catholic. So the biggest thing was we were a big minority in that town. At any rate, and my father was very, he was very involved with civil rights and, you know, he would go and preach at all black churches. So we were the only white family that would go with him to, you know, hear him preach in all black churches in the South. So you know, there was some of that intermingling that went on, not a lot, but enough that made a big impression on me as a 10, 11, 12-year-old. You know, you're very impressionable at that age. So that was my culture that I grew up in, a family that was kind of bucking the system there. I mean, that was a lot of my girlfriends and stuff were, you know, from families that were very racist, very, mm-hmm. you know, they were, but I, you know, you know, kind of, you see it how your own family sees it and what you're trained, you know, to see. Mm-hmm. So I can say that, you know, a white girl that's kind of in the middle of this, like I was, grew up watching discrimination against African Americans of still like ramp. I mean, Jim Crow laws were everywhere then. This is in like 19, in the 60s, in the early 60s. So things were just ready to take on. They hadn't even exploded yet, but they were getting ready to explode. The pressure cooker was on. So how I saw the world was, oh my God, there's all this unfairness out there. There's to me, there was cognitive dissonance about like how you're supposed to treat people and how people are being treated and how wrong it is. So, you know, and I just believed that, you know, civil rights were going to happen and women's rights were going to happen and that, you know, that it would be, you know, that things would be, the march of progress, Philippe, was happening. Mm-hmm. And so for me, just to tell, just personally, November 8th of this year was devastating to me. Devastating. All the things I've been working for, raised to believe, you know, this, you know, all of a sudden to realize that there's all this chunk of this country. Remember, I live in a blue state. I live on the coast. I live in California on the coast. It's like everybody around me is pretty blue, or if they aren't blue, they keep their mouth shut. You know, so my current culture is very much kind of like I hang out in like a Bernie Sanders world here. I mean, it's
right,
like,
right.
And you know, a belief in equality and justice for all, and liberty, and you know, male and female being equal. That's the culture that my little culture now that I live in. So I was devastated because I feel like we've just ripped the fabric of our society that we've been trying to stitch together for all the years I've been alive, for 60 plus years, and it's just been ripped apart. And I don't know how we're going to move towards keeping it stitched together right now. I mean, hate against others who aren't like you, you know, female freedom and female, you know, having your own, being able to choose your own path in life has a lot to do with, you know, being able to control whether you get pregnant or not, your reproductive rights. You know, that is step one for young fertile females. if they can't control their fertility somehow, then, you know, I know it affects males too because their partners are males, but it's usually not their problem, as I say, you know. And so to think that we might take apart Roe v. Wade and things that are just considered normal health care in Europe and Israel, other countries that are Western countries consider reproductive, you know, birth control and you know, abortion if you need it, whatever you need as a healthcare reproductive thing in other countries, it's not a political issue, it's healthcare. So to me, to take that apart though is really keeping women enslaved to something they don't have to be enslaved to.
What do you think of in terms of Muslims, African Americans in this country after the election? What is your feeling on in terms, what type of socialization do we need to begin developing or subscribing to so that we can create new epigenetic tags? And particularly if you could talk about, can we overwrite or override our epigenetic tags? Can we flip the switch? Can we change it? And if so, what are some of the ideas and ways that we can do that?
Yeah, I mean, I think that re-engineering your epigenetic switches is actually, fortunately, the human brain is the biggest, most powerful learning machine that we have. So you can learn to install new switches, so to speak. And I think, if I can tell you, Philippe, from my personal, like growing up in a family that was a religious but socially active, ecumenically open to all religions and all races. And, you know, basically, I think that the religious community right now is our big hope to try to stitch things together with Muslim families, with Christian, with Jewish, with, you know, with all different sects, sheikhs. I mean, you've got to be able to, you know, Zoroastrian. We have many, 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 many religions in this country. And I think that the leaders, the religious leaders of those communities need to build a way for their young people in grade school and junior high years to come together in kind of ecumenically mixed summer camp, you know, or into like groups that get together that even go, you know, feed the homeless together with, you know, a Muslim, Christian, you know, that religious community, we need them all to get together to really try and stitch our country and the different societies and different religious groups, which also means the different racial groups, back together. So that would be one of my hopes and prescriptions, you know, for, and pulling down the gauntlet challenge to religious leaders in this country is don't make hate work. You can change the epigenetic wiring of a lot of your young people in your religious community by giving them experiences with people who aren't of the same religion. But we all, you know, all religious people at some level share that deep belief that all human beings are equal. They deserve love and care. They deserve to be treated fairly. I think that is the basis of some piece and some chunk of all religions has a piece that believes that and has religious mandates and passages that basically teach their practitioners that. So, you know, we need to call on our religious leaders in a big way right now.
Not splitting hairs and taking sides or sounding or being divisive, but I'm just going to go there in the sense that because we're just having this conversation and that thank God people like you exist and the studies that you've done exist and the books that you've written exist, that in our previous conversations that you and I have had, you talked about how this socialization, because you know there was a lot of CNN, MSNBC, ABC, all of them, you know, did interviews and had their pundits on there saying, well, Is Trump a racist? Is this cabinet that he's forming, are they racist? Are they bigots? Are they, you know? And you talked about how you can propagate hate in the brain circuitry, but you can be completely unconscious of your mental state. So if you're unconscious of your mental state, and I ask you, are you a racist? You'd probably say, oh, I'm not a racist at all. Do you hate Muslims? Do you hate women who are not on the scale of 1 to 10 of 10? Or, you know, if they're 1, do you hate them? No, I don't hate women. I don't hate Muslims. Can you be completely unconscious? And this is different than cognitive dissonance, but can you be completely unconscious of your social wiring and circuitry?
Yes.
Okay. Well, that's the end of that question. Okay, great. That's for our next show, ladies and gentlemen.
Because Philippe,
I mean, it's a powerful piece, is it not? I mean, that's really huge.
It's huge. So I think it's important, like the cognitive dissonance is where you're actually consciously feeling some struggle in yourself between feeling like you should treat somebody nicely, but you feel hatred towards them, or you know, that's most of us don't walk around like, you know, the brain does not like cognitive dissonance. The brain does not like feeling that tension. So the way we get away, I mean, nobody likes that. Think about your relationship, your marriage. I mean, you know, like when you're feeling conflict with your spouse, this is not comfortable, right? That's cognitive dissonance of the worst kind.
It's like when you have to apologize, but you really don't want to.
Yes, exactly.
To keep peace and to move forward, but it's just something I can't apologize because that would be conceding or weakness or whatever. But you just can't apologize, and so I can see that cognitive dissonance as it relates to race relations.
So what happens, though, in a marriage, you can't get away with it because you're living in the same house as somebody else, right? But in your society, if you're say raised in, like, going back to our KKK versus Bernie Sanders family kind of thing, you know, if you don't want to walk around feeling cognitive dissonance when your family tells you to, you know, hate people of color, right, or to, you know, that they're to be feared, they're to be jailed, they're to be, you know, all the stuff we're talking about. You don't walk around with cognitive. So the way we deal with it in terms of our brain basically is able to kind of like put it in a little box that you're not conscious of. It's in a little box where it's got a lock on it, you know, and believe me, it's often Pandora's box in there. You don't dare open that sucker because it could be bad, you know. Even in a relationship, in your marriage, like, there's stuff in that box you don't go there, and you learn not to go there, right? But, you know, so it's about, you know, that Pandora's box. We have a lot of those in our brains, you know, for a lot of stuff. You know, like in a marriage, you have some of those things where you don't dare talk about her mother or her sister. I mean, that's a no-fly zone. And it's the same thing with racism or hatred of a different group or of, you know, it's in your little box in your brain that you just don't go there. And you don't even sometimes know it's there until, you know, you're faced with it. Like, just even like, let's say, I don't know what your situation is, but if you're faced with something about your sister-in-law, your brother-in-law, somebody in the family that you just can't take. I mean, most of the year, except for the holidays, you don't go there. You know, you say, well, that's the bad place. You say, well, you know, in hatred and racism, you often just stay away from those people. You don't have an interaction with those people. So you don't even know until you're faced with a situation. You're always kind of just unconscious of that.
And that's called racial stress. And in whites, it's known as white fragility. And with African-Americans, it's African-American fragility and racial stress. And what happens when whites or blacks are faced with an inevitable racial stress situation, how does the brain react? How does it respond? Now, we can see this manifest in police brutality and just the, if you will, for lack of a better term, the itchy trigger finger as it relates to African-Americans. Black men in particular, but Black women now as well. Nobody's safe now. No gender is safe. But we can see that racial stress, that cognitive dissonance, that when it's that epigenetic, you know, tag that just overwrites logic and says, oh my God, I'm so afraid, bam, 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 and then that's it. And we can also see the socialization, because I'm sure some people will say, well, some of the people who have killed Blacks are not white, and it's not racism. I say, well, if you look at the political and socialization of policing and law enforcement, law and order, you know, that, you know, goes all the way back to slavery and was you know, brought out in the Nixon era and the Reagan era. We can see there's a socialization there where you're fearing a particular type of group of people that live in a particular area more so than others. So this is fascinating what you're bringing out, that there's just an unconscious bias based upon our epigenetics, so based upon our socializations that imprint our epigenetics in this ornamentation.
Now, like you say, a police department is a little society. That is your little culture, and you do not want to be ostracized from that group.
Right.
You're a Black police officer, you're a white police officer, a brown, a Muslim, a woman. You do not want to be seen as quote unquote different and be ostracized from your group, because it means you will die. I mean, you know, in your brain circuitry, you just have fear of being ostracized. It's like, that is like automatic. So anything that means you're going to announce yourself as being different than that group and might be ostracized, you just keep your mouth shut. So it's, you're right. It's like that happy, itchy trigger finger towards the stereotype of dangerous Black male on the street, whatever. It's not going to be different for a female policeman, a Black policeman, a Muslim. You know, it's not your, that is their culture inside the police force. It's the same exact wiring of, do not do anything different than your group. You know, you have your partner's back, you know, no matter what. You know, all of those rules in police departments, the leadership of the police departments has to change that dynamic and dialogue. So that, you know, there has to be, that it will change only when kind of the social do's and don'ts inside police departments change, because that's the group that all those officers are relating to about the do's and don'ts. They don't want to be ostracized no matter. So you know, that's their society versus what their gender or their race is.
This is very powerful. Last question, remember in our conversation, you had mentioned something about taking a deeper look at the Second Amendment as it relates to slavery and white men being able to bear arms. Talk to form militias or what have you. Can you speak to that?
So I'm not an expert in that area, but the parts that's kind of the part that speaks to me and the things that I've been reading about the origins of the Second Amendment and also the issue of slavery in this country, and also where whites have not really apologized to Blacks in this country for slavery in a sufficient way. Let's call it out.
Mm-hmm.
In relation to another country who has done a lot, which is, of course, is Germany, has very much apologized, right? They very much apologized to, you know, and they've done a whole different thing in their education system.
Mm-hmm.
So, and the telephone will be picked up by my answering machine. So.
No problem. It's so funny how we do that. We just act like, oh, there's nothing ringing. It's
right,
not there.
Right.
We're just a cognitive dissonance to the phone, right?
It's cognitive dissonance. I know, exactly. So.
Now the phone needs to go and have some type of socialization so its epigenetic tags won't, you know, feel ostracized.
Yeah, exactly that. So I think that it's really important, though, back to the Second Amendment part of things, in that I'm not an expert. I would love to have you have someone where you can really drill down on the following, which is my little pieces of understanding, that the right to bear arms was given for militias, and militia, you know, that basically militias wanted the right to bear arms, and that what one of the functions of militias in the South was that you were a young, so white teenage boys, you had to join the militia in your community to make the rounds every night. And the rounds were to keep find any slaves that were out after curfew, or to punish slaves, as the militia had that as their job in the South. And that they obviously wanted to be able to bear arms for, you know, that So the Second Amendment has a whole piece of it that had to do with keeping slaves enslaved and basically policing slaves. The Second Amendment has those origins, and I would love to somebody that's you'll find in your expert database, Philippe, that is an expert in those. But that little society, going back to little society groups, so those little militias, those white male militias in slave states, had this same dynamic going on. Anybody who didn't like what they were supposed to do, to bear arms and go out and catch slaves that were out after curfew, or ended up sometimes being lynching mobs to basically keep the system going. Even though you're a white male that didn't like that, you didn't go outside your social group and be ostracized. It was dangerous to be ostracized outside of that white militia group that was, enforcing slavery in the South. And that's the right to bear arms. I never realized it had that aspect to it until, all of the recent political discussions and writings about it. So that might, but that's another example of these epigenetic, changes in what your culture expects you to do and not do. And the people that were the white community that were part of the militias, you got to be a hero to step out of those tight mm-hmm. social groups.
It's different than a cult. I mean, cult, absolutely. Culture. We can say that racism is a cult. The system of racism is a cult.
And that you're not free. I mean, one of these things we're talking about, these really you feel like you die if you get ostracized from your social group. I mean, there's a piece of that that's part of the brain circuitry of all of us in terms of wanting to not be seen as different in our social group for fear of being ostracized, and therefore our brain will feel like we're going to die if we get ostracized, right? Which, of course, we won't. So, to understand that dynamic in the human brain, you can then realize that the important thing you got to do early on, it's dangerous to have these types of groups in our society. You need to mix and match. You need to have children in school together. You need to have different religious groups doing things together as a community and mixing genders, mixing races. You need to have that because the danger of these tight social groups, for what starts to happen to your brain circuits as you raise the next generation, it's too dangerous for a democracy to exist. You can't have the feedback and the openness and the freedom and the liberty that we expect if you're going to let all these little pockets of hatred and xenophobia exist. We have to actively do something about it. We can't, because the brain circuits are so quick to form that way. You've raised that society. I mean, we all have family members probably who have been raised in different kind of ways, and we think, how are they going to get more of an open mind? An open mind comes from education and experience of other people not like you, and that they're not dangerous, they're not going to kill you, and that you bring that experience as a child back to your own group. You have to actively, as a society, do things that counteract this tendency of the brain to form tight social circles that you feel you can't step out of, or you're going to die because you're going to be ostracized. That is the biggest danger to a democracy that there is.
Wow. Let's end it there, because that's huge. Thank you for that. I am so honored to have this conversation. Whew, we saved the world right now. For just an hour, we saved the entire planet, particularly America. But this, we've got to share this everywhere. Just because, again, that part of awareness, once you understand how your brain is working, how you got there, how did you develop your level of thinking, this is how.
And how you have to structure society and organize it in a way to counteract that natural tendency to build those two tight social circuits that are building your social brain.
Wow. Well, we're not ending it here, because you're coming back in a couple of weeks. And we're going to have an even more powerful conversation. I'm not going to give it away because it's a surprise. But I absolutely appreciate you, Dr. Brizendine. You have been, well, you literally, there are people in my life that I can say, various different parts who changed your life, who augmented your experience. You were one of those persons I can honestly write in my history that says, wow, she really made an impact. I appreciate your work and I appreciate what you're doing in the world. And I just appreciate who you are.
Thank you, Philippe. And the feeling is mutual. Thank you for putting this voice out into America that needs you so much right now.
Thank you so much. So much for that. Thank you guys for watching. Share, comment. Let's continue the dialogue. And we'll see you guys next time on the Philippe Matthews Show live. And Doc, stick around in the green room as we sign.